Hey, everybody. Welcome to WMUR Politics Plus here on our digital channels, if you will, Facebook, Twitter, all those things. Adam Sexton, John DeStaso, breaking down the week's political news and kind of taking a look ahead and a look back, because this is probably the last time we'll be together to do this before through the holidays here. So,
possibly.
John, let's start out with the big news that broke last night with Senator Hassan taking to the Senate floor to essentially reverse her position on the filibuster and say now she is in favor of eliminating that rule for to be able to pass the a version of a voting rights bill, essentially.
Yeah, I mean, not being in Washington, I don't know if this was something that had been expected, but I know that you and I communicated last night, and I think we were both surprised. Neither of us got sort of a heads up that this was going to happen. And they're trying to kind of walk a line here, Adam, right? Because they want to do a carve out. She's not against all filibusters, just the filibuster relating to voting rights issues. I assume the Senate can change its rules, you know, to say whatever they want it to say.
A semi-nuclear option.
So I was told this morning that's the new Freedom to Vote Act, which is the new version of the For the People Act, and also the John Lewis Voting Rights Act, which failed 50-49, received 50-49 positive vote in early November, well short of the 60-vote filibuster necessary. So those two are the two pending bills that the senator was referring to, and her statement was quite, you know, quite intense in the way she talked about, she didn't use the word fraud, but she basically said that that Republicans across the country are, you know, being less than honest about how they're treating voting and letting people vote.
There's really nothing that Senator Hassan does that isn't meticulously thought out and planned.
That's right.
So, why this and why now, do you think?
Boy, she's probably getting, I mean, I don't know the exact reasons why yet. We're all working on that, I guarantee you. But I assume she got a lot of pressure from the leadership. I assume they want to, you know, she's in favor of those bills. So now, since they both failed to reach the filibuster, she was probably getting some pressure from the leadership and probably thought about it, and also looked across the country and saw that some of these Republican bills in state legislatures are either in place or pending that she doesn't like, and felt that it was the right time.
And this would be the idea that of legislative supremacy, that a legislature could essentially try to invalidate the results
of
an election.
Yeah.
I'm curious, just looking at this, you know, you wonder, you know, from a, you know, strategic or a victory standpoint, you know, Democrats just had this Build Back Better situation.
Right.
Have we got an incoming call here? No.
No, we had something from, not the one I was hoping for.
Yeah, no, I think, you know, for progressives, right, you know, it's almost like they were just told with this Build Back Better failure, I'm sorry, Christmas is canceled, Santa's not coming this year,
right? That's right.
And so they are very upset. And there, a lot of that is focused on Senators Joe Manchin and Kristen Sinema. But, you know, Senator Hassan has been out there saying no to a few things here and there, too. Not as out in front of it like Manchin and Sinema, certainly not in that league. But I think she probably maybe had to do something with this progressive base here. To me, a telling thing was that the Senate floor speech was made, and then it was straight to MSNBC and Rachel Maddow, which is communicating to a very specific audience, saying, essentially, I'm here with you on this issue. So that covers that in some ways, and we'll see how it plays here in New Hampshire.
I agree. There's been, just to point out, though, there's been no prospect of any primary challenge to Senator Hassan from the left.
And they can't even find a candidate for governor.
That's right. So, you know, I agree that she probably wanted to placate the progressive wing, but they were not going to reject her next November.
Right.
If she had not done this.
Right. Some base shoring up being done
so
here.
I think it had more to do with what was happening down there.
Right. That's true. Yeah, inside baseball a little bit. Let's shift gears to a little, yearbook, year in review type stuff. What do you think was your biggest political story of 2021?
Boy, that's really hard to say. I mean, it's not that there were that many,
It's a slow year, speaking, you know, broadly, for New Hampshire standards, when we normally have, you know, presidential candidates coming in.
Right.
A non-election,
well, I mean,
non-heading into a primary
Adam, right,
year.
For all of us, the big story was the governor's announcement
right.
Just last month that he was not going to run for the Senate, speaking of Senator Hassan. And that was something that took up a lot of our time and a lot of our airwaves and web space, if you will, throughout the year. So I think that that was the biggest story. There's also obviously the story about a lot of the voting bills that we were talking about here in the legislature.
Right.
How COVID affected the legislature was another big bill. And another big issue, I should say, that's still pending in the federal appeals court.
Mm-hmm.
But I think ultimately, if we have to zero in on one story, it was definitely Governor Sununu's decision to, you know, shun the recruitment of Mitch McConnell and company and run for a fourth term.
Right. I agree with you there on that, you know, on both fronts, you know, that, you know, sort of the biggest state level story, if you will, being the, you know, Republican legislature checking off so many boxes
yes,
on its wish list
exactly.
with such a narrow majority. That's something we probably hadn't seen in a long time.
Yeah.
At the State House, if
ever.
The
issues in House Bill 2, right?
Right, exactly. All that
the,
stuff.
The freedom accounts.
To me, the consequences that sort of redound or the dominoes that fall or don't fall from Governor Sununu's decision not to run for Senate. You think about Kelly Ayotte now sort of going back to the private sector with the position with the board at BAE Systems.
Right.
And, you know, Chris Pappas potentially not running for governor. You know, the trajectories of so many different careers here are different now because of you know, the decision that Chris Sununu has made. And of course, the little hints that he was dropping along the way, you know, we'll see what happens with this of, you know, being open to a run for the president.
Yeah.
I think, you know, to me, we'll see about that. You know, he did say very clearly in his press conference, you know, I think that day that he announced it, as soon as I make my decision, maybe this is a little bit before, as soon as I make my decision, I'll question it, you know. And I think maybe we're seeing a little bit of now of the governor, you know, some of that attention is off and things like that, and maybe he's a little...
And as we go into 22, real quick, I mean, this Senate story is going to explode as soon as the holidays are over.
Yeah,
you're going to have several. I believe we're going to have 2-3, maybe more Republicans who actually do run, and others who we think may run are going to step back, and there may be people who we don't know about yet.
Right. To shift gears, what do you see as your biggest story of 2021, looking ahead? I'm sorry,
2022.
I don't want to leave this year, I guess.
It will be, I mean, honestly, all the above, because it'll be the Senate race. Mm. I don't think there's any question about that. And then how the First in the Nation primary campaign plays into the Senate race. Who's going to come and we'll be inundated with potential Republican presidential candidates campaigning against or for the various Republican candidates. Same time getting their names and profiles raised high.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's going to be a big story. Another big story to watch will be the First in the Nation primary itself, because both political parties now are taking up the calendar for 2024. They're going to be doing that, not to get too nuanced here, but they're going to be doing their rules committees, will be meeting starting in February. I know the Republicans are having their winter meeting in early February, and the Rules and Bylaws Committee will meet, and they will begin to discuss the calendar, how the parties will treat the calendar. Our understanding, of course, is that the Republican Party is probably happy with New Hampshire being first in the nation. Democrats, that's where the mystery lies.
Right.
And as you interviewed Chairman Harrison, Jamie Harrison, last week, honestly, I interviewed him back in May, and he hasn't changed his position.
Yeah.
He's going to be very careful about it.
Very, very careful.
But behind the scenes, who knows? One thing that is true is that he is very friendly with Chairman Buckley, but he also is chairman of the National Party, and there's going to be a lot of pressure. Ultimately, normally when you have a president in the White House, and you're the party in power, It's what the president wants.
Right.
The president calls the shots.
Yeah.
Will this president do that?
Yeah, and I think if I had to pick...
After finishing fifth in the primary.
Right, that's true. And if I had to pick a story to look ahead in 2022, it is, does Joe Biden manage to climb out of this hole that he's in right now? Because that will impact, you know, the Senate race and all these other things if the president is able to, you know, sort of change the trajectory that his presidency is on right now. So, you know, I guess I make a lot of football analogies here, but, you know, if you look at these as 4 years, as four quarters, you know, he started out the game with a pretty good drive, you know, getting a Rescue Plan Act passed, and then things did not go well after that. This was, you know, if the first quarter of the game, they're looking at that right now, and they're behind, you know, and if he's, the good news for him is he's got a lot of time to dig out of that. And so, to me, you know, a lot of people had written him off after Iowa and New Hampshire. He had said, I'm going to take a gut punch and move on. And he did pull himself out of that. So we'll see if he can resolve that, you know. But to me, and to channel Donald Rumsfeld, the late Donald Rumsfeld a little bit, to me, there's also the unknown unknowns, right?
Sure.
You know, you think about something like COVID that came basically out of nowhere, you know, even though it was a slow developing story. You got to wonder in 2022 if there's something that's going to happen that we're not thinking about right now, or something that's sort of in the background, like a Taiwan situation, you know, something international, something involving foreign policy or the military that suddenly will upend everything we're talking about and reshape the conversation. Because that's in large part, that's kind of what happened to Joe Biden in August, you know, this withdrawal from Afghanistan, which he had talked about and everybody kind of wanted, you know, fell to pieces. And that really is when we started to see him crater in terms of public opinion.
There's time for him to pull out of it. They passed the bill. If they can pass a Build Back Better plan, their theory is that the you know, the results of that will be happening right in the fall, and that will help the Democrats. So, and we'll again, the underlying question about Biden will also be, of course, is he going to run for re-election at his age? To be honest,
Something to keep an eye on.
Yeah.
All right. Well, hey.
It's great. Yeah.
If we don't see you again here on Politics Plus,
well, maybe I'll be on Zoom.
Yeah, you know. That's right. Maybe we can do something right on, you know, back, probably not next week.
Adam, but, if you want me back here, I'll come back.
All right. Yeah. Now we can get everybody on Zoom. We'll have to have a big party.
Well, I mean, if you want another do a live, I'll be here.
Awesome.
Okay.
All right.
Thanks.
For John DeStaso, I'm Adam Sexton. Thanks for watching WMUR Politics Plus.